Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, your surgical educator from Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching videocasts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. So in this episode today, I am going to discuss the laparoscopic inguinal hernia repair. So it has got two approaches. The inguinal hernia repair has got two approaches. One is the transabdominal preperitoneal approach, known by the acronym TAPP. And the second one is the totally extraperitoneal approach, or known by the acronym TEP. So obviously the advantage of TEP over the TAPP is because the peritoneum need not be, covered over the mesh. That is one thing. And second thing is the potential complications by opening the peritoneum in case of TAPP will be avoided in case of TEP approach. So the lap inguinal hernia approach, the recognition of anatomy of the preperitoneal space is essential for a safe and effective lap hernia repair. So this is the anatomy after entering into the, the peritoneal cavity. If you look downwards towards the, the pelvis, you will be looking exactly the same thing. So the centrally you are seeing, this is the bladder, and you should recognize some important anatomical landmarks here. One is the median umbilical ligament, which I am showing it here. This is the remnant of uracus. And then laterally here you are seeing the medial umbilical ligament. These are here also, and this side also, right and left, both sides you are seeing two medial umbilical ligament. These are remnant of the umbilical arteries. Then here you are seeing the lateral umbilical ligament. Here also you are seeing the lateral umbilical ligament. Actually, this is the peritoneal fold over the inferior epigastric artery. Then you must also recognize three fossa. This is the supravesical fossa, which you are seeing here, this one, and this is the medial inguinal fossa. This is the Hasselbalch's triangle through which the direct hernia will protrude, and this is the lateral inguinal, pre-vesical pouch, and this is the lateral inguinal pouch. So here you will get the, here you can see the, internal ring opening also. This is the lateral. Here also you are seeing the lateral inguinal pouch, where you are having the internal ring opening, and through which the indirect hernia occurs. And there is another triangle which I will show you in the subsequent picture. Here in the second picture, you are seeing this part of the organs are covered by the peritoneum. This is what you will be seeing in TAPP approach. Whereas here the peritoneum is removed. This is what you will be seeing in a TEP approach. In a TAPP surgery, TAPP approach, you have to make a peritoneal incision like this. All other structures, this is the internal ring, and this is the vas deferens, and this is the spermatic vessels, and this is the iliac vessels. These are the nerves. A lot of nerves will be there. The genital branch of the genitofemoral, and the femoral branch of and lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh, all these things will be here. And apart from that, you can recognize, and this is the this is the gonadal vessel or spermatic vessel in this one, and this one also. And here you are seeing these two are iliac vessels, artery and vein, and this is the vas deferens here. And what you are seeing here is the ureter. You are seeing it here clearly. So when you are approaching this area, these two triangles are very important. That is called triangle of the doom and triangle of pain. So this triangle of the doom is bounded by, this is the vas deferens and this is the inferior epigastric, I mean the testicular vessels. So in between the vas deferens and the testicular vessels, this area is called triangle of doom. It contains the major vessels, the iliac vessels it contains. This is a regular triangle, whereas the adjacent one, this is formed by the iliopubic tract above. This is the iliopubic tract, and here medially, this is the gonadal vessels or testicular vessels. Here you are seeing, and this is an inverted triangle. In this, there are lot of nerves are there. So when you are fixing the mesh, you should not apply the suture or the stapler or the tacks over these areas. You will be, if you are doing it here in this triangle, okay, you will have lot of bleeding, because you will be injuring these major vessels. If you are going to dissect or apply tacks in this triangle, okay, because these nerves will be involved, the patient will be having severe neurologic pain post-operatively. So here you are seeing exactly this what I told. So this is the mess you are seeing in the second picture. So you have to apply these black dots are tacks by which only you are fixing this mesh to the anterior abdominal musculature. Here you should not apply these tacks above the iliopubic tract. Only thing is, superiorly you have to avoid it, but here medially, okay, you can apply even over the Cooper's ligament also. You can apply here, you can apply here, but never go below this red line. That is the thing. Another important anatomical thing is the coronamortis. This is nothing but an abnormal, or accessory obturator artery that is joining the, this is the obturator vessels, both artery and vein, and this is the external iliac artery and vein. So there'll be an anastomosis. See, external iliac and obturator anastomosis. So if this anastomosis is there, if you are during your dissection, if you are injuring these vessels, the accessory or abnormal obturator artery or vein, okay, it will bleed to death. And that is why it is called coronamortis or the crown of death. This also is an important anatomical factor you must know. Then coming to the anterior abdominal wall musculature anatomy is a must if you are doing a TEP approach. So knowledge of anatomy of the abdominal wall muscles, specifically recognition of the transition zone that occurs at the arcuate line of Douglas, is the key to the success of the TEP repair. Because below this arcuate line, there is no posterior rectus seat. This is the important anatomical factor you must know if you are, attempting for a TEP repair. So here you are seeing the first picture. This is above the arcuate line here. So here you are having, apart from the peritoneum and transversalis fascia, the rectus abdominis muscle is also having a posterior rectus seat above this arcuate line. Whereas below the arcuate line, okay, there is no posterior rectus seat. Instead, only peritoneum and transversalis fascia is there. So you have to dissect in between the transversalis fascia and peritoneum. This is what is called pre-peritoneal space. So this anatomical factor is also important. After entering into the anatomical phase, the space, you have to go towards the pelvis, where you will be able to see the the pubis, and this space is called just in between the space in between the pubic symphysis and the bladder is called space of Retzius. Then you have to go laterally. This is a diamond shaped space. Then you have to go laterally up to this area, and this space is called space of Bogras. Both this dissection is very important in TEP repair. So what are the indications for lap inguinal hernia repair? So indications are, you have to do laparoscopic repair only in recurrent hernias and bilateral hernias. The role of laparoscopic repair of primary unilateral hernia is debated, and it is not recommended. So you have to do only for recurrent hernias and bilateral inguinal hernias. Contraindications, those patients who are unfit for general anesthesia and those who are having active infectious or inflammatory process, because this may, produce the infection of the mesh. So, and then the strangulated and incarcerated hernia, you should not approach by, the lap repair. And previous retropubic open prostate surgery, especially for TEP repair, this previous history is not, it is a contraindication for lap approach, especially for a TEP repair. Anesthesia, you should use only general anesthesia with endotracheal tube intubation. So you have to obtain informed consent after explaining the risk of this sort of surgery. So recurrence is a common complication. The common cause is the technical fault or usage of a smaller mesh. Bleeding can be avoided. You have to avoid dissection in the triangle of doom and beware also of the accessory obturator artery, which I was discussing. This is called the coronamotis. And neuralgia is another complication. This is because of injury to the genitofemoral or the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. Damage to the vas, bladder injury, especially in TEP approach, seroma, hematoma, and hydrocele formation, bowel obstruction because of post-op addition, especially in TEP repair. All these things you have to explain, and of course, you have to explain regarding the mesh infection also, you have to explain, and then you have to get the informed consent from the patient. So what are the pre-op preparation you have to do? You have to obtain an informed consent, including conversion to open repair if necessary. Consent for contralateral repair if unsuspected hernia is identified at laparoscopy. You should mark the hernia side also. Ask the patient to empty the bladder immediately before the induction of anesthesia. Otherwise, you have to catheterize the patient. Place the patient supine with the head and slightly lower, that is the Trendelenburg position, to keep the bowel away from the operating side. Place the monitor at the foot end of the table. The surgeon should stand on the side opposite to the hernia. Coming to the position in theater setup, slight head down position, I told you already, that is Trendelenburg position, to keep the bowels away from the pelvic area. Both arms are tucked by the side to make enough room for surgeon and assistants to move. So here both the arms should be tucked and monitor should be kept here. The surgeon should be standing. This is a left-sided hernia, so surgeon is standing on the right side. And the camera holder can stand opposite to the surgeon, and the scrub nurse can stand by the side of the surgeon, and first assistant, if requires, can stand by the side of the camera operator. Here you are seeing the monitor, and here you are seeing the anesthetist with his anesthesia machine. So then you must create the pneumoperitoneum. For TAPP repair, you can use either the closed or VRS method or the open and Hansen's cannula method. This is what you are seeing. The first picture, you are seeing the VRS method level. Make a small incision, then put the VRS needle in inside and insufflate until the pressure comes to, the pressure will be, should be kept below 15 millimeters of mercury. This is one method, and this is the Hansen's method or Hansen's cannula open method. But in TEP repair, you had to use only this Hansen's cannula or blind method only you had to use. This is the carbon dioxide auto-insufflator. This will be depicting the pressure here and how much the rate of flow and how much you have already utilized, how much of the gas you have utilized will be depicted here. And here you will be seeing how much gas is remaining still in the cylinder. That also you can see here. So coming to the port placement for TEP repair, the first port should be at the umbilicus. This is a 10 mm port, this one. And then one on each side at the lateral border of the rectus muscle, both are 5 mm, slightly at the level of umbilicus or slightly lower than umbilicus. You have to place at the lateral border of the rectus muscle, 2-5 mm port. But port placement for TEP repair, the primary port is a 10 mm infra-umbilical port. This you have to put this, this primary port under vision. And then the secondary ports, 1-5 mm at suprapubic here, and another 5 or 10 mm in between these two ports, the third port you can put here. So for TAPP approach, the first thing after entering into the peritoneal cavity, you have to do the incision of the peritoneum. Before that, you have to reduce the hernial content. It may be omentum or intestine, maybe going into the internal ring, that you can reduce it. And then you have to start incising the peritoneum. This is from medial umbilical ligament to anterior superior iliac spine, 2 centimeters above the internal ring. This is what you are seeing here. This is the internal ring here. So you have to start it. This is the anterior superior iliac spine. You have to start incising the peritoneum up to the medial umbilical ligament. You have to go from anterior superior iliac spine to the medial umbilical ligament here. So then you have to elevate the flaps, the lower flap and the upper flap. This is what you are seeing here. This is an actual, the operative picture. You are seeing it. You have to open this incision, and you have to, the peritoneal flap is dissected towards the iliac vessels. Inferiorly you have to dissect, and then superiorly the upper lip, you have to towards the anterior abdominal wall muscle. You are seeing the abdominal wall muscle here. This has to be elevated, the upper flap. The peritoneal flap includes the hernial sac also. While you are dissecting inferiorly, part of the, this peritoneum will be going into the, the internal ring. So this is a technique for direct hernia, will be easily, it is reducible. If you pull this, the peritoneum, it will come out. But it is, with very large indirect inguinal scrotal hernias, the distal part of the sac is divided and left within the scrotum. The proximal part can be ligated. This is what you have to do in a very large indirect inguinal hernia. Direct sac, easily you can reduce it. Only in very large indirect inguinal hernia, it is difficult to reduce. So dissection of the preperitoneal space. You have to dissect this areolar tissue, which I have shown in the previous one. You have to identify important anatomical landmarks like the Cooper's ligament, iliopubic tract, the internal ring, the vas deferens, the gonadal vessels, iliac vessels, and the various nerves. You have to identify all the structures here. You have to dissect this fat also. Dissection of the cord structure and vas deferens. You have to do what is called parietalization of the cord by Stopa's. Stopa only has described this parietalization. That means you have to skeletonize the cord structure. That is what it is. So what you are seeing in the first picture, still the part of the, the hernial sac, or the peritoneum is the hernial sac that is attached to the cord structure. So you have to do what is called the blunt dissection of the hernial sac from the cord, and you have to remove any attachment to the vas deferens also. That is what you have seen in the first picture. In the peritoneal sac is still attached to the cord, whereas in the second picture, we are doing a blunt dissection with this gauze piece, and then peritoneum has been completely removed from the attachment to the cord structure. This is what is called parietalization or skeletonization of the cord. This you must do. So then after you have done all these things, you have to do, the next step is placement and fixation of the mesh. So rolled up mesh is loaded through the umbilical port. This is what you are seeing in the first picture. It has to be rolled up, and then you have to introduce it through the umbilical port. Then you have to unroll the mesh and place it over the three hernial orifices, and this is called the direct inguinal hernia orifice, indirect inguinal hernia orifice, and the femoral hernia orifice. This is called collectively known as the myopectineal orifice of Fruchi. Medially, this mesh should cover up to the median umbilical ligament. It should go exactly up to the midline. Then you have to fix the mesh with either with tacks, fibrin glue spray, or even with sutures, you can fix this mesh. Laterally, it is essential to stay above the iliopubic tract. This is what I told you, above the iliopubic tract. But medially, tackles are inserted into the rectus muscle and even on Cooper's ligament. This is what you are seeing here, over the rectus muscle and over the Cooper's ligament here. So laterally, it should be above the iliopubic tract. So you should not apply none of these tacks below this red line. This is what you have to follow. And this is the triangle of doom and this is the triangle of pain. Here also, you should not apply this because both these triangles are below this red line. You should not apply these tacks over these triangles. Then the next step is you have to close the peritoneal flap. With the mesh now secured in place, the pressure of the pneumoperitoneum is reduced to 9 from 15 millimeters of mercury. You have to reduce it to 9 millimeters of mercury. The peritoneal flap is replaced over the mesh and it is closed with the tacks. The tacks being used are absorbable to prevent future adhesion. Otherwise, if the tacks are not absorbable, then there may be adhesion formation with these tacks. So it is better to use absorbable tacks. Ideally, the tacking is performed in an overlap fashion. Here you are seeing the second, this one is, you have to overlap the flaps and then you have to apply the stapler or tacks. Otherwise, if you are closing like this, there will be gapping in between, and through these gaps, okay, the intestine can go and form an adhesion with the mesh. So you have to better close like this overlapping method. If tacks are not available, then you can even use continuous running suture. It can use to close the peritoneal flap. This is what you are seeing here in the second picture. Continuous suturing also you can do to close the flaps. After removal of the ports, the skin incisions are closed with single interrupted suture. After careful closure of the fascia, only in 10 mm trochar port. The 5 mm trochar port, you need not close the fascia. You have to close directly the skin. Whereas in 10 mm port, you have to close the fascia and then you have to close the skin. Coming to the TEP approach, this is the first step is the initial entry into the preperitoneal space via the open technique. So you should know the anatomy of the anterior abdominal wall musculature. So you have to make an infra-umbilical incision either vertically or transversely just lateral to the midline. So then you have to put two retractors used to slide the lips of the incision to the right if the hernia is located on the right side, or to the left if the hernia is located on the left side. The anterior rectus sheath is now exposed on the side of the hernia. It is then open under direct vision and two stay sutures of 2/0 vicryl you have to place. The rectus muscle is then separated by two retractors introduced right into the rectus muscle itself, so that the posterior rectus sheath is now visualized. This is what you are seeing. This is the anterior rectus sheath. You have to go through it and then go through the muscle. And then at this point, don't cross the posterior rectus sheath, because here you are seeing the posterior rectus sheath. Don't go vertically like this. You have to go obliquely. Yeah. You have to head downwards towards the symphysis pubis in an oblique fashion using either your index finger or a small peanut with an angulation of about 30 degrees. This will lead to the preperitoneal space below the arcuate line of Douglas. This is the arcuate line. Below that only you have to enter so that you can avoid the posterior rectus sheath. So So obliquely, you have to go there below the arcuate line and then you enter this space. Now you are having only the transversalis fascia and the peritoneum. There is no posterior rectus sheath here. Directly you will be entering into the and if you put your the trocar and cannula, you can see if you are in the correct plane, you can see the this is the rectus abdominis muscle above and the peritoneum with pre-peritoneal fat, you can see here. This is what should be the, this is the pre-peritoneal space, this is the appearance. So the next step is you have to dissect the pre-peritoneal space either with balloon, or if you want to cut down the cast, you can even use the your telescope itself for dissecting this space. So the pre-peritoneal space is dissected using a balloon spacer under direct vision with a 0-degree laparoscope. One should be careful to dissect in such a way that inferior epigastric vessels stay with the rectus muscle. This is what you are seeing here. This is the trocar with this, with the balloon. So next, the Hassan port is introduced with a video laparoscope with an angulation of about 30 degree. And then you have to put two 5 mm ports or place at midline between the umbilicus and symphysis pubis. So at this stage, you have to inflate this balloon for few seconds, and then you can deflate the balloon, and then you can maintain this one by insufflating carbon dioxide inside, but the pressure should be below 9 millimeters of mercury. Because care should be taken not to perforate the peritoneum, the pressure should be less than, I told you, 9 millimeters of mercury. Otherwise, okay, it can rupture either the peritoneum here and it will produce pneumoperitoneum, or the gas can leak here and it will produce emphysema here, the subcutaneous emphysema it will produce. If the peritoneum is perforated, it should be closed with an endoloop or a 5 mm clip. If there is any perforation here, it should be closed. Otherwise, this space you cannot get. All the gas will go into the peritoneal cavity. So you have to close it. This is what you will be seeing. First, you have to introduce it in a deflated manner. This is the pubis. And then you have to inflate this balloon. And finally, you have to maintain this space by insufflating gas, carbon dioxide, into this space. This is the pre-peritoneal space. This is the peritoneum you are seeing. This is the pubis and this is the bladder. Then you have to identify all anatomical landmarks in the pre-peritoneal space, and then you have to apply the mesh, and then you have to fix it. So the first thing is the pubic bone and Cooper's ligament are identified by its glistening white color, and this is called lighthouse sign. And another thing is you have to, from the Cooper's ligament, if you dissect downwards, you can see the iliac vessels and especially the iliac veins. You should not injure these iliac vessels, and for that you should not dissect below the level of iliac veins. The operative field should be identical to that we have seen in the TAPP approach. Small hernial sac can be easily reduced, no problem with small hernial sac or with direct hernia. If you pull it, okay, the whole sac will get reduced. If it is a large, especially indirect inguinal hernia, after reducing the content, you have to transect the sac and leave the distal end open, and the proximal end you should close it immediately with endoloop or 5 mm clip. Otherwise, the gas, the carbon dioxide in this space through this peritoneal hole, it will enter into the intraperitoneal cavity. So you have to close it with either by endoloop or by 5 mm clip. Then you have to introduce the mesh in a similar manner. You have to roll it, you have to introduce it, and then you have to roll it out or spread it out over the all three hernial orifices, that is the indirect hernial orifice, the direct hernial, and the femoral hernia orifice. And this is called the myopectineal orifice of Fruchter. All three should be covered. Then only you have to fix the mesh with either with tacks or with sutures, but you had to avoid the triangle of doom and triangle of pain. That means you should not apply this tack below the iliopubic tract. So this in this picture you are seeing the identical anatomy. This is the internal ring, this is the iliac vessels, and this is the iliopubic tract, and this is the Cooper's ligament you are seeing here. This is the iliac vein, and these are the nerves you are seeing, genitofemoral nerve, and this is the vas deferens you are seeing here, and this is the testicular artery and vein. So the same anatomy. The most important thing is, if it is a big indirect hernia like this, you have to apply a clip and then you have to amputate this distal end. You need not close it, whereas the proximal end already, because clip has been applied, or you have to suture ligate this area. This is how you have to tackle the hernial sac, indirect hernial sac. So what is the post-op care? Most of these repairs are day care procedure, and patients can be discharged with a prescription of mild analgesic agent. Mobility, you can ask the patient to move immediately after the procedure. You should give prophylactic antibiotics to prevent mesh infection, because in both the approaches, TAPP and TEP, we are using a mesh. You can allow fluids within 4 to 6 hours after recovery from anesthesia, and then progressively you can advance to semi-solids and to the solids. Time off from the work should be 3 to 6 days. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that these videos are very useful, kindly subscribe to this channel and share this video with your social media. I request all my viewers to view the actual surgery, because I'll be giving the links for both TAPP and TEP as end cards here in this slide. It will appear here in this area, so you can click those links and you can watch the actual surgery also. So after seeing this video and after going to see the actual surgery surgery video also, especially the surgical trainees and even the practicing surgeons, you will have what is called a mental rehearsal for the surgery. Just before going to do the actual surgery, you should see this before going to surgery, so that you will become more confident in doing the surgery. But I request my viewers, don't try to do this surgery just after seeing these videos. You have to get trained from a master surgeon, then only you have to try to do these surgeries. So thank you once again.